In romantic style, Paul Cézanne painted his later wife Hortense. Only in the early period of his career, he allowed his emotional feelings to be expressed in his work. He created some 200 paintings exploring the theme of female and male nudes disporting in the landscape, singly and in groups, which he will call bathers. This is an example from his dark or romantic period, 1870. And these four bathers, painted 7 years later, are an example from his impressionist period. Cézanne's bathers derive in part from pastoral images of female bathers, such as the goddess Diana and her maidens, long favored in French art, like this painting in French mannerist style of François Clouet called The Bath of Diana. Cézanne, with some exceptions, one of which we have seen in video 1.2, did not use direct literary sources. This naturalist painting of five bathers, dating around 1887, is an example from his mature period. There is interaction between the bathers. They seem to have a good time together. In the same period, Cézanne's good friend, the impressionist artist Pierre-Auguste Renoir, painted these large bathers. With this painting, Renoir attempts to reconcile the classicist tradition with modern painting. Cézanne, however, developed in that period in the opposite direction, further away from classicism. Renoir never again devoted the for him so painstaking effort to a single work. At the end of his life, 12 years after Cézanne's death, Renoir painted these bathers. Much less conform nature, showing that development in modern art was unstoppable. During the last decade of Cézanne's life, his final period, this bathers motif culminated in three huge paintings. This is the version of the Barnes Foundation in Marion, Pennsylvania. At the time of his death, he seems to have been at work on all three versions simultaneously. Because of their size, they were called the large bathers, les grandes bagneuses. The three paintings epitomize his movement toward abstraction and share numerous traits. For example, the bathers' faces are nearly devoid of detail and definition, their bodies merge with the landscape, and narrative content is scant or missing. The Barnes version is the most intentionally and densely modeled and painted, clearly the most worked over. For that reason, most art historians agree that it is the earliest version of the three. As mentioned before, he worked on all three versions till the very end of his life. In 1905, in the year before his death, Cézanne posed in front of the present version. Interestingly, the woman on the left lost her place in the immediate foreground of the painting. This version of the large bathers is housed in the National Gallery in London. There is a salient harmony of the figures with the landscape, expressed through solid forms and strict architectonic structure and the earth tones of the bodies. This bather is shown from two viewpoints. We see more of her back and bottom than under a single point of view. This version, housing in the Philadelphia Museum of Art, is the largest of the three. It measures about 2 by 2.5 meters. Although it is unfinished, it is considered by art history experts to be the most resolved. Primed areas of unpainted canvas create many whitish areas, while the figures in the lower right barely obscure earlier contours. The three versions of the large bathers are comparable. The nude androgynous figures form two groups on each side of the foreground of the paintings, and surprisingly, Cézanne was a strong opponent of the classical style in painting, he uses the classical pyramidal device, an imaginary pyramid roughly outlining the lineup of each subgroup. Notwithstanding the various poses of the figures, the two opposing pyramids create a balance in the picture which is reminiscent of the work of Renaissance artists. In the Philadelphia version, the presence of the pyramid structures is even further emphasized by the leaning trees forming an enormous triangular structure acting like a great vault over the human figures. It was Leonardo da Vinci who pioneered this composition of a human pyramid in the Virgin of the Rocks, his foremost early work, showing the Madonna, the Christ child, with the infant John the Baptist and an angel in a rocky setting, which gives the painting its unusual name. We see here the version of the Louvre Museum from 1483-86. The use of a pyramidal device for the arrangement of figures might be called one of the characteristics of the High Renaissance, in which artists began to strive for unified compositions, giving their works a more harmonious appearance. Michelangelo's Pietà, a sculpture made in 1498-99, is also an example for the striving for harmony in art. The two figures are carved so as to appear in a unified composition which forms the shape of a pyramid. This Madonna of the Meadow with the Virgin Mary in a contrapposto pose, the Christ Child and Saint John the Baptist is a 1506 painting by Raphael. Like in the foregoing Renaissance works, a sense of serenity permeates the scene. The three figures are enclosed by an upright symmetrical pyramid. This complexly composed painting by Titian from 1556-59 in Mannerist style portrays the moment in which the goddess Diana discovers that her maid Callisto has become pregnant by Jupiter. Complexity is notable in Mannerism. No longer elegance and beauty are based on good proportions or harmony. Postures are artificial, twisted, and movement is emphasized. Nevertheless, Titian applies the pyramid device to arrange his figures in space. Comparable to Cézanne's large bases, Titian uses two tilted asymmetrical pyramids, making the scene more vivid and dynamic. In the immediate foreground of the painting rests one of Diana's hounds. Indeed, also in the Cézanne's Barnes version of the large bases we saw before, on the same location in the painting lies also a dog, although a much more domesticated specimen. Could it be that the Barnes version, the earliest version of the three large bases, is inspired by Titian's Diana and Callisto, and that Cézanne, who depicted dogs hardly, if any, with his dog, pays tribute to Titian as the source of inspiration? In any case, the similarities in the composition of both paintings are evident. This is Nicolas Poussin's depiction of a bacchic scene from circa 1627. At Cupid's command, the goat-legged shepherd god Pan has knelt and taken Venus, the goddess of love, on his shoulders. A little winged Pluto is giving a hand, and the group is accompanied by a sturdy faun bearing a basket with fruit and glassware on his head and back. Poussin has painted many scenes of nude figures in a landscape. His work was a great inspiration for Cézanne. In part 1.2, we already mentioned the influence of this leading painter of the classical French Baroque style. Perhaps more than any other artist of the Baroque, Poussin obsessively theorized about his art, painstakingly planning every detail of his composition in order to create maximum impact. This painting is based on one Renaissance pyramid, which seems perhaps too much a restriction for this vivacious scene in the open air. A last example of a composition based on the pyramid is the famous Raft of the Medusa by Theodore Géricault, dating from 1819. Géricault was an influential pioneer of the French Romantic movement. In this dramatic depiction, we see the surviving men of the raft of the foundered French frigate, the Medusa. The classical rendering of the structure of the composition stand in contrast to the turbulence of the subject, as was more or less the case in Poussin's picture. But Géricault, like Titian in Diana and Callisto, based his composition on two tilted human pyramids. While the Bezos paintings were initially not well received by the public, Cézanne's fellow artists were immediately enamored of them. When the English sculptor and artist Henry Moore saw one of Cézanne's versions of the large bases in 1922, he was stunned by its composition and said, "If you asked me to name the 10 most intense moments of visual emotion in my life, that would be one of them." French modern painter Henri Matisse bought in 1899 this Three Bases by Cézanne. When he donated the painting to the Petit Palais Museum in Paris, he wrote in a letter to the art curator, "In the 37 years I have owned this canvas, I have come to know it quite well, though not entirely, I hope. It has sustained me morally in the critical moments of my venture as an artist. I have drawn from it my faith and my perseverance. For this reason, allow me to request that it be placed so that it may be seen to its best advantage." In this remarkable loosely painted watercolor of Cézanne from his final period, we see bases with the Mont Saint-Victoire in the background.